чим-чим-ни, чим-чим-чими, а сліпи за злабим, а злабимими. Чим-чим-ни, чим-чим-ни, чим-чим-чими, good luck will above when he shakes hands with you. Chim-chim-ni, chim-chim-chiri, chim-chim-chim.
It is London in the Edwardian era, 1910 to be precise, and spring has brought forth the cherry blossoms in great profusion along Cherry Tree Lane, a fashionable residential area. In the adjoining park, Bert, a street entertainer, is delighting residents with his one-man band. After the crowd disperses, he heads for home, pausing just long enough to greet Admiral Boom, who is on the deck of his ship-shaped home. The Admiral warns there is heavy weather brewing at number 17 Cherry Street Lane, the home of the George Banks family. The household is in an uproar, for the youngsters, Jane and Michael, are missing. Their nanny has resigned, the cook, Mrs. Brill, and housekeeper, Ellen, are quarreling, and Mrs. Winifred Banks is tied up with her latest cause, getting women the right to vote. Nana abruptly departs, running headlong into Mr. Banks, who is returning home from a day at the bank, totally unaware of the chaos taking place in his home. This makes his next move all the more hilarious as he relaxes with his pipe and sherry and expresses his satisfaction with his home, family, and station in life.
A surge of deep satisfaction, much as a king astride his noble steed, when I return from daily strife to hearth and wife, how pleasant is the life I lead. Splendid, splendid.
I'm
my home precisely on schedule. At 6:01, I march through my door. My slippers, sherry and pipe adieu at 6:02. Consistent is the life I lead.
Yes, yes, yes.
It's grand to be an Englishman in 1910. King Edward's on the throne, it's the age of men. I'm the lord of my castle, the sovereign, the liege. I treat my subjects, servants, children, wife, with a firm but gentle hand. Noblesse oblige. It's 6:03 and the heirs of my dominion are scrubbed and tubbed and adequately fed. And so I'll pat them on the head and send them off to bed. Ah, lordly is the life I lead.
Mr. Banks's dream of a well-ordered life is quickly shattered, of course, when he learns from his wife that the children are missing. While he is calling the police, Constable Jones appears on the scene with the two stray youngsters, Jane and Michael. They are appropriately apologetic as they describe for their parents what led them astray, their kite, which got away from them in the park. The children are sent to their room with a disgruntled Ellen in charge as George assesses the dismal situation. He points out that Winifred has been singularly unsuccessful in employing any nannies with any staying power whatsoever, six having been employed in the past 4 months. George decides to take over and to place an advertisement in the Times for another nanny.
Take this down, please. Wanted. No. Required. Nanny. Firm. Respectable. No nonsense. A British nanny must be a general. The future empire lies within her hands. And so the person that we need to mold the breed is a nanny who can give commands. Are you kidding this, Winifred? A British bank is run with precision. A British home requires nothing less. Tradition, discipline, and rules must be the tools. Without them, disorder, catastrophe, anarchy. In short, you have a ghastly mess.
At this point in composing his advertisement, George is interrupted by Jane and Michael, who have completed their own advertisement. However, their requirements for the perfect nanny are quite different from those of their father.
Wanted, a nanny for two adorable children.
Won't hide your spectacles so you can see. But don't
Of course, Mr. Banks is not at all interested in a kind, witty, very sweet, and very pretty kind of nanny at all. He prefers the solemn, stern, scowly type of nanny. He impatiently tears their suggested ad into little tiny pieces and flings it into the fireplace. However, unbeknownst to Mr. Banks, the bits of paper mysteriously and magically are drawn up the chimney and out into the night sky. 8 o'clock the next morning is signaled by a loud discharge from Admiral Boone's cannon, and a long line of stern, ghastly-looking nannies are assembled at number 17 to be interviewed. Jane and Michael, watching from their nursery window, are pretty disappointed at the prospects. Then, quite suddenly, the wind shifts from the east and begins to blow with almost hurricane force. One by one, then two by three, the queue of nannies is lifted skyward and blown away. From the other direction, the children catch sight of a very different-looking nanny, Mary Poppins herself. With her umbrella in one hand and her carpet bag in the other, she floats through the sky, on the breeze, and lands at the doorway of number 17, where she is quickly ushered in for an interview. Mr. Banks is so bewildered by the children's ad she is holding in her hand, the very one he supposedly destroyed, that Mary Poppins conducts the interview herself and succeeds in engaging herself as the new nanny. The children are delighted. Mary Poppins is just the nanny they had hoped for in their dreams. When she slides up the banister on the way to the nursery and unpacks everything from mirrors to plants to lamps from what appears to be an empty carpet bag, Michael suspects her of being a little tricky. But Jane assures him she is wonderful. Mary Poppins then tells the children it is time to play a game called Let's Tidy Up the Nursery. Jane and Michael are instantly suspicious, for this is a job they detest. They have no idea what surprises Mary Poppins has in store for them.
Shall we begin?
It is a game, isn't it, Mary Poppins?
Well, that depends on your point of view. You see, in every job that must be done, there is an element of fun. You find the fun and snap! The job's a game. And every task you undertake becomes a piece of cake. Unlike a spree, it's very clear to see that
sweet.
little nip from every bow that they slip, and hence they find the Torskis not a grind. Maras, Boonbosh, Maras, the medicine go down, just a spoonful of sugar.
I thought that song was a little longer. I was in the kitchen. where are we? Okay. Spoonful of sugar. That was great. That was delightful with the bear. Okay. Moving on. Next, it's time for the children's daily walk. And Mary Poppins has an outing in mind. She leads them down the sidewalk to the park entrance, where they meet Bert, the street entertainer, who today is plying the trade of a screever, or a sidewalk artist. He suggests that they go for a stroll through one of his chalk drawings. In a flash, with some of her best magic, Mary Poppins takes all of them, Bert, Jane, Michael, and herself, into the middle of one of Bert's most beautiful drawings, a picturesque English countryside. Everyone is dressed now in fancy, jolly holiday attire and filled with excitement. When the children hear the sounds of a merry-go-round coming from a country fair just down the road and behind the hill, they run off for a carousel ride. This gives Bert and Mary a bit of time to sing about their jolly holiday, including an unusual dance with some most unusual performers.
Bright as the morning in May, I feel like I could fly.
Now, Bert, none of your larking about.
Have you ever seen the grass so green or a bluer sky? Oh, it's a jolly holiday with Mary. Mary makes your heart so light.
You haven't changed a bit, have you?
When the day is gray and ordinary, Mary makes the sun shine bright.
Oh, honestly.
Oh, happiness is blooming all around her. The daffodils are smiling at the dove. When Mary holds your hand, you feel so grand. Your heart starts beating like a big brass band. Oh, it's a jolly holiday with Mary. No wonder that it's Mary that we love. Oh, it's a jolly holiday with Mary. Mary makes your heart so light. When the day is gray and ordinary, Mary makes the sun shine bright. Oh, happiness is blooming all around her. The daffodils are smiling at the dove. When Mary holds her hand, it feels so grand. Your heart starts beating like a big brass band. Oh, it's a jolly holiday with Mary.
No wonder that it's Mary that we love. Oh, it's a jolly holiday with you, Bert. Gentlemen like you are few.
Can't you read, that's me.
Though you're just a diamond in the rough. Underneath your body is blue.
Come on, darling.
You'd never think of pressing your
very kind.
Anything for you, Mary Poppins.
You're our favorite person.
It's true that Mavis and Sybil have ways that are winning. Prudence and Gwendolyn set your heart spinning. Phoebe's delightful. Mona's disarming.
Felicia? Lydia?
Charming. Winifred's dashing. Vivian's sweet. Stephanie's smashing. Priscilla's a treat. And Jane, convivial company, time and again. Dorcas and Phyllis and Glynis are sorts. All agree are three jolly good sports, but cream of the crop, tip of the top.
It's Mary Poppins and there be stop.
Mary rejoin the children for a carousel ride, but the horses soon prance off the merry-go-round and take the riders for a brisk gallop across the countryside. Suddenly, a horn is heard in the distance. A fox hunt is in progress, and the group becomes caught up in the action. Bert feels sorry for the tired little fox and rescues him from his pursuers. Mounted on his merry-go-round steed, Bert and the fox leap over a hedge, smack onto a track in the middle of a horse race. Mary and the children join the action too, and the winner of the race is Mary Poppins herself, of course, crossing the finish line well ahead of the other riders. She is escorted onto the winner's circle and then interviewed by a number of newspaper reporters. One interviewer remarks, "There probably aren't very many words to describe your emotions, are there, Mary Poppins?" But of course, Mary Poppins always has a response.
On the contrary, there's a very good word. It's
supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. Even though the sound of it is something quite atrocious, if you say it loud enough, you'll always sound precocious. Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
Because I was afraid to speak when I was just a lad. Me father gave me no's and tweak and told me I was bad. But then one day I learned a word that saved me aching nose. The biggest word you ever heard, and this is how it goes. Oh, supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. Even though the sound of it is something quite atrocious, if you say it loud enough, you'll always sound precocious. Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
He traveled all around the world and everywhere he went, he'd use this word and all would say, "There goes a clever gent."
When it's in my garage, just spends the time of day with me. I use my special word and then we'd all go to tea. Oh,
supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. Even though the sound of it is something quite atrocious, if you say it loud enough, you'll always sound precocious. Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
You know, you can say it backwards, which is docious alli expiistic fragicalileepus, but that's going just a bit too far, don't you think?
Oh, indubitably.
So when the cat has got your tongue, there's no need for dismay. Just summon up this word and then you've got a lot to say. But better use it carefully or it can change your life.
For example?
Yes?
When that I said it to me girl and now me girl's me wife.
Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
Even the best of holidays must end, sadly, and this one does so with thunder showers, washing away the beautiful backgrounds of Bert's sidewalk drawings. The little group finds themselves back on the sidewalk in the park, and Mary Poppins rushes the children home to dry off and to go to bed. However, Jane and Michael insist they are much too excited to sleep and recount the day's adventures. Mary Poppins tells them to find, you know what, suit yourselves. Then begins to sing them a soft, sweet, soothing lullaby. I was supposed to tell a joke on that last one, I forgot. All right. The next morning, its advent announced as usual by Admiral Boom's cannon salute, finds a disarming change in the bank's household. The cook and housekeeper are no longer fighting. In fact, Mrs. Brill is singing to herself, and Ellen hasn't broken a dish all morning. When the children march into the dining room singing supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, George finds all of this to be much too cheerful and heads for the bank in somewhat of a huff. Mary Poppins and the children leave to go shopping, but before they have gone very far, they are stopped by the barking of Andrew, a terrier who has some very serious news for the trio. Uncle Albert has had a reoccurrence of an old malady and needs Mary Poppins' help immediately. The morning's plans are abruptly changed, and Mary, Jane, and Michael rush to his home. They ring the doorbell and are ushered inside by Bert, who has already arrived. He says he has never seen Uncle Albert this bad before, and that's the truth. As they head for the living room, Bert is concerned about the children seeing Uncle Albert like this, because his condition is so contagious. Jane wonders if they might get spots or something, but Mary Poppins says this is highly unlikely, for you see, Uncle Albert is suffering from excessive laughter. The more he laughs, the more buoyant he becomes. And as they enter the parlor, they find him bouncing about the ceiling. Excuse me. His laughter is infectious indeed. And before long, first Bert, then the children, and finally Mary Poppins herself floats upwards to join him for a merry tea party on the ceiling.
Thank you.
That evening, when Mr. Banks arrives home from the bank, Jane and Michael tell him all about the day's adventures, including one of the jokes they heard about a man with a wooden leg named Smith. George refuses to believe this preposterous story and calls in Mary Poppins to upbraid her for taking the children on such questionable outings as horse races and tea parties on the ceiling. He says the children need to learn purpose and practicality. And once again, the interview gets strangely turned around. Mary Poppins agrees with him, and that tomorrow, just as he suggests, pressed and dressed, Jane and Michael will be at his side for an outing to the bank. While informing the children of the outing with their father, Mary Poppins tells them all about the pigeons near St. Paul's Cathedral and the bird woman who sells her bags of crumbs to feed them for just a tuppence a bag.
Thank you.
The next day, on the way to the bank with their father, Jane and Michael see the bird woman, just as Mary Poppins had described her. Michael has tuppence from his money box and wants to buy a bag of crumbs for the birds. But Mr. Banks will not permit it. He does not want the boy to squander his money on a lot of ragamuffin birds. Instead, he tells Michael that when they get to the bank, he will show Michael just what he can do with his tuppence. At the bank, the chairman, Mr. Dawes Sr., his board of directors, and Mr. Banks tell the children how Michael's tuppence can be invested in the bank. In so doing, he will achieve a sense of conquest and expand his affluence accordingly. Unfortunately, Mr. Dawes, with his greed showing, snatches the tuppence from Michael's hand. Michael is frightened, but furious as well, and shouts, "Give it back!" as he grabs for his money. His exclamation creates a stir in the bank, and other investors, hearing the altercation, panic. They rush to remove their savings, and a run on the bank ensues. Jane and Michael manage to evade Mr. Dawes Sr. and the rest of the directors and escape through the chaotic throng, fleeing from the confusion into a maze of dark and foreboding alleyways. Soon, they are hopelessly lost and completely scared. Turning a corner, they run headlong into a filthy man dressed all in black, who turns out to be Bert. He's so dirty because he is now working as a chimney sweep. After calming them down a bit, Bert escorts the children home with a merry song about his latest occupation.
Chimney's a wondrous thing. It's built strong and tall, right up there on the roof. When the wind is just right, it blows across its top and pulls the smoke right up the flue. Here now. Feel the pull on the end of that brush. like you got a will on the end of that line, ain't it?
Chimney, chim, chimney, chim, chim, chiree. When you're with the sweet, you're in glad company. Nowhere is there a more happier crew than them what sings chim, chim, chiree, chim, chiree. Chim, chimney, chim, chim, chiree.
You never know what might happen around a fireplace.
Oh, bother!
Michael, where are you? Michael, back!
Well, that's a bit awkward.
I must say.
Bert, I'll pin ideas in their heads. There goes the other one.
Shall I go after them?
Well, we can't have them gallivanting around up there like kangaroos, can we?
Next, once on top of the George Banks home, Mary Poppins, Bert, Jane, and Michael set out on an expedition across the rooftops of London, up and down, all around, from house to house and chimney to chimney. The sooty group marches on, even climbing up a magical smoky staircase to the pinnacle of a tower where it seems as if the whole world is at their feet. And as Bert likes to say, who gets to see it but the birds, the stars, and the chimney sweeps? The night air turns chilly, so Mary Poppins provides a magical smoky elevator to return the group to the top of the Banks' home. Suddenly, the sound of chiroo, chiroo is heard, and a group of Bert's chimney sweep pals appears, ready for a rollicking celebration of Step in Time.
Step in time, step in time. Come on, mighty step in time.
Step in time. Step in time, step in time, step in time, step in time. Happy to reason, happy to run. Step in time, you step in time. Kick your knees up.
Unfortunately, Admiral Boom mistakes the merrymakers for a group of attacking Hottentots. right, Hottentots. He loads his cannon with rockets and fires on the dancing chimney sweeps. To escape the bombardment, everyone slides down the nearest chimney, which just happens to belong to the Banks family. The dancing continues throughout the house, with Mrs. Brill, Ellen, and Mrs. Banks joining in. Imagine the shock and dismay when Mr. Banks appears at home just in time to witness this joyful chaos swirling around in the middle of his usually well-ordered domain. This brings the celebration to an abrupt halt, with all the sweeps shaking his hand for good luck as they depart. Angered by the intrusion and by what took place at the bank earlier in the day, George confronts Mary Poppins, blaming her for all of his troubles. After she takes the children upstairs, he confides in Bert, who has remained... Oh, that's better sounding. Okay, I'll talk like this. In Bert, who has remained behind to finish cleaning the chimney. After some reflection, Bert helps George realize his weaknesses as a father. Afterwards, Jane and Michael apologize to their father for the trouble they caused at the bank and give him the tuppence, hoping it will solve everything. Later, Mr. Banks is summoned to the bank, where he assumes responsibility for Michael's actions with the tuppence. Then, he is solemnly sacked, cashiered, discharged, removed from his position at the bank. However, in the midst of this devastating turn of events, George finds the tuppence in his pocket and is suddenly overwhelmed by a strange succession of thoughts. He realizes that Mary Poppins has been right all along, and blurts out supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, discovering that it really does make one feel better. He remembers Bert's songs and all the amazing things he has heard about Mary Poppins. Pressing the tuppence into the hands of Mr. Dawes Sr. and laughing uproariously, George recounts the outrageous joke the children heard from Uncle Albert about a man with a wooden leg named Smith, then dances merrily out of the bank. Mr. Dawes and the board of directors are sure that Banks has gone completely mad. Then the elder Dawes suddenly gets the joke, and wheezingly, he starts to laugh. Slowly, he rises out of the chair, exactly as it happened at Uncle Albert's. The members of the board try to grab him and pull him back down while he floats through the air, and his elderly son pleads, "Daddy, please come back." The following morning, the wind changes direction, and in the nursery, Jane and Michael sadly watch as Mary Poppins starts packing her carpet bag. She reminds the children that she said she would only stay until the wind changed. Downstairs, Mrs. Banks is anxiously pacing the hallway, distraught over the absence of her husband, who has been missing all night. Ellen, Mrs. Brill, and Constable Jones offer their sympathy and concern when an unusual sound is heard emanating from the basement. It's George Banks himself. He emerges through the door, smiling and singing, "A spoonful of sugar makes the medicine go down." I sang a little bit. Holding the children's kite, which he has been mending, he calls for the children. Mary Poppins sends a tearful Jane and Michael downstairs with a firm spit spot. Their sadness is immediately turned into wide-eyed joy when they see their smiling parents and the newly repaired kite proudly held out to them by their father. Mary Poppins knows that it is indeed time for her to leave. The Banks are now, finally, a happy family.
With tuppence for paper and strings, you can have your own set of wings. With your feet on the ground, you're a bird in flight. With your fist holding tight to the string of your kite. Oh, let's go fly.
Where the air is clear, oh, let's go. want to congratulate you. Capital bit of humor. Wooden leg named Smith or Jones, whatever. Father died laughing.
Oh, I'm so sorry, sir.
No, we're very sorry, nonsense. Never seen him happier in his life. He left an opening for a new partner. Congratulations.
Oh, thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much indeed.
As the kites soar higher into the air, Mary Poppins opens her umbrella and floats upward as well into the London sky until at last she disappears from sight.